thank you. So the role of imaging techniques for disease evaluation is multiple. And first of all, we know that imaging is a part of the demonstration of the CRAB criteria, so the presence of bone disease and of a symptomatic disease needing the start of treatment. We also need imaging to identify sites of eventually extramedullary disease. We need imaging to make a precise differential diagnosis between a localized disease and a systemic disease. We need imaging for the correct identification of sites of bone disease at eventual risk of complication. And last but not least, in the last years, it became clear that we also need imaging to define precisely the response after treatment, in particular in patients with non-secretory myeloma. So in the last years, the definition of myeloma bone disease was refined and changed, and this is the new one. So nowadays, the definition of the presence of bone disease is the presence of one or more sites of osteolytic bone destruction, whether it is seen on CT, whole body low-dose CT, PET CT, regardless of the presence at the whole body skeletal survey. This is why Johan said that maybe his flowchart should be updated. And secondary, the osteoporosis per se, not attributable to myeloma, and to attribute osteoporosis to myeloma, you need mainly an MRI, is not sufficient anymore to define a symptomatic disease. Also, we were able to demonstrate that the presence of early bone disease, that is to say early bone marrow infiltration demonstrated by MRI, it is also representing a symptomatic disease. So nowadays we don't need any more at any cost to demonstrate a hole with an osteolytic lesion, but we can also consider that patients having more than two focal lesions on MRI are patients with active disease. Of course, we should take care of doubt lesions, either on PET CT or MRI, because when we have very sensitive techniques, we can have doubt lesions. And for this reason, the International Myeloma Working Group is recommending a close follow-up, for example, after 6 months, for patients that, or a biopsy when possible, for patients with doubt lesions. So why this major change was done in the definition of myeloma bone disease? Because we do have novel imaging techniques, and all of them demonstrated to be more sensitive when compared to whole body X-ray and to have a higher detection rate. So this was very clear, and this is the reason why the definition was changed. What is the plus of these novel imaging techniques? The plus is that most of them do have a morphological part, which is assessing bone destruction, but they also have a functional part, which is assessing either bone marrow infiltration or the disease metabolism. And this is the case of all the functional techniques for MRI and of PET CT. So for this dual capability of novel imaging techniques to be morphological techniques, but also functional techniques, we can use them for the staging, and this is what I've told you just now, but also for the evaluation of response to therapy. So regarding the staging, I will just show you a summing up slide, because I'm not able, not myself, but all the International Myeloma Working Group, to make a clear recommendation of what is the best technique to be used for the staging, because each of the techniques has some plus and some minus, and so it is difficult to recommend one or the other. However, we may say that whole body low-dose CT is the more easy one, the most, which is giving low radiation dose with a quite low cost, the most available in most centers. So in many centers, this technique has replaced the standard whole body X-ray. However, with PET CT, you can also have a prognostic information and you can have a metabolic information, and it is the best technique to identify the presence of extramedullary disease. While with MRI, you do have no radiation exposure at all. You know that it is the gold standard for the detection of the diffuse bone marrow involvement and eventually to identify complication of the disease, in particular in the spine. So it is difficult to make a recommendation, and what I'm seeing and what I'm discussing is that people usually is making a choice according to the local clinical practice, to the resources and to the expertise. However, I may recommend that it could be ideal to use the same technique at baseline and for the evaluation of response to therapy, and this is not all over done. A second important point was that 2 years ago, the International Myeloma Working Group introduced for the first time in the disease evaluation response criteria the category of minimal residual disease evaluation. And this was done after the clear demonstration that the achievement of minimal residual disease after therapy, it is very important for the outcome, both for progression-free and overall survival. So I will focus, of course, on the imaging part, because there will be another presentation focusing on the other two, so the flow and the molecular MRD negativity criteria. So here it is stated that imaging MRD negative patients are those who are achieving a complete suppression of FDG metabolism by PET-CT. So let's see why this was defined. First of all, why there was the need to introduce in the MRD evaluation criteria also imaging. We have some data demonstrating that the achievement of MRD negativity on PET-CT, so the complete suppression of disease metabolism on PET-CT, is complementary to the achievement of minimal residual disease in the bone marrow as evaluating by flow cytometry. And in this data coming from patients who received autologous stem cell transplantation up front with novel agents that are achieving a complete negativization of the MRD in the bone marrow, but also of the PET-CT focal lesion, have a better outcome as compared to patients who are staying either positive for one of the two techniques. And the biological reason explaining why there can be a discrepancy between the bone marrow MRD negativization and the imaging negativization resides on what is called the spatial genomic heterogeneity of multiple myeloma. And this was clearly demonstrated by our colleague from US, from the Little Rock group, who showed that the genomic of the disease can be different in the bone marrow and in the focal lesion. Here are some examples of patients with a JAP low risk in the bone marrow and the JAP 70 high risk in the focal lesion. So for this reason, the disease may respond to the treatment in the bone marrow, but may resist outside the bone marrow in the focal lesion. And also, it was demonstrated by the Spanish group that patients having a diagnosis bone-related or extramedullary plasmocytomas are those at the higher risk of having a residual disease outside the bone marrow. And this is the case for these 6 patients. As you can see, they had a plasmocytoma diagnosis, and after the therapy, they reached an MRD negative results in the bone marrow with a high sensitivity, again, patients receiving VRD and autologous stem cell transplantation, but retained some positivity in the focal lesions. So I told you that we are now able to evaluate disease metabolism after therapy thanks to the fact that we do have these functional techniques that are able to evaluate the suppression of disease metabolism after therapy. The first demonstration was almost 10 years ago, and it came again from the Little Rock group, where they demonstrated that patients achieving during treatment, so before autologous stem cell transplantation, negativization of focal lesion at PET-CT had a significantly improved outcome in terms of progression-free and overall survival. The same concept was demonstrated some years later in an independent series of Italian patients, again, newly diagnosed transplant-eligible patients receiving novel agents and double autologous stem cell transplantation. Again, negativization of PET-CT was prognostic and was independently prognostic for progression-free and overall survival. And finally, we had a third series, again, of newly diagnosed transplant-eligible patients, and again, the same concept. The negativization of PET-CT before maintenance had a significant and independent, as you can see from the multivariate analysis, prognosis meaning for progression-free and overall survival. What about patients achieving conventionally defined CR? We know that some of them, approximately one-third of them, 25 to 30% of the patients in conventionally defined CR, could still have a PET positive results. And as you can see in this retrospective analysis, again, patients with a positive PET CT had a worse outcome as compared to patients achieving a negativization of PET CT. So to summarize the results on PET CT, we have a three independent prospective series of patients showing that it is important to achieve a complete metabolic suppression by PET CT. The results in CR patients are less strong because they are coming from a retrospective analysis, and also we do have conflicting results on a small series of 45 patients treated in US with a very intensive treatment, and we don't know if this is difference is a sample issue or we should consider a different sensitivity with more intense regimen. However, we also know that a small percentage, but still present, of patients, approximately 10 to 15%, are false negative by PET-CT with FDG. These are the patients who are not expressing an enzyme that it is necessary to capture the FDG within the cells. So in this patient, I may say that FDG PET-CT is not a good tool to evaluate minimal residual disease after therapy because they are falsely negative. So one may think of changing maybe the biomarker, and we know that we do have different biomarkers such as choline or methionine that are even more sensitive, and we do have several studies demonstrating a higher sensitivity of this marker. Or we could go through the way of looking for a specific tracer, for example, daratumumab, and we had a murine model using this tracer for the demonstration of the disease. However, we could also make change of technique. And so I told you that another functional technique is MRI. What about using MRI for the evaluation of response to therapy? The standard either axial or whole body MRI, it is not really ideal because focal lesion may stay longer after treatment, and so we can have false positive results. But in this regard, we were helped in the last year by the implementation of MRI with functional software able to capture either difference in perfusion, and this is the case of dynamic contrast enhanced MRI, or capturing the difference in cellular density, and this is the case of diffusion weight MRI. And we do have several independent series of small patients where we were able to demonstrate that these techniques are working in demonstrating changes in the metabolism of the disease, either early on treatment or also at the end of therapy. So for sure, we have an alternative to PET-CT, which is to use this functional MRI that are for sure highly sensitive and highly promising. However, to date, we do have some issues with the standardization of the results and with the interpretation of the changement in these changes that are very, as I told you, very quick, very early on treatment, and so should be better interpreted. So for this reason, nowadays, and this is what the recommendation that I showed you, the International Myeloma Working Group is recommending the use of FDG PET-CT. But I may say that in the future, this may change, incorporating these other different techniques. So we do have still some open issues in the allowing us for a clinical widespread use of imaging techniques to evaluate response to therapy. The first one is the standardization issue, and it is ongoing, in particular for PET-CT. We should compare PET-CT and MRI in a prospective way, and there are several trials ongoing that have a serial evaluation with both the techniques. But most importantly, to my opinion, we should decide how to incorporate imaging MRD with the bone marrow MRD, and how to use this to modulate therapy. And in this regard, Very recently, the Little Rock Group demonstrated that patients negativizing focal lesion either during or after treatment have the same outcome as compared to patients not showing a high metabolism upfront, introducing the concept of treatment until suppression of focal lesion. And of course, to validate this concept, we need clinical trials. And this is the first clinical trial that was just proposed by the Nordic group, proposing a stratification of patients made on PET-CT and PET-MRI, and proposing additional and further therapy for patients who are still PET positive after induction or autologous stem cell transplantation. So to conclude, I may say that the novel imaging techniques are now standard of care in myeloma patients, and they proved to be reliable and to be that they can be used in several different settings of patients. For the evaluation of response to therapy, the favorite techniques are PET-CT or the functional MRI. And for sure, now we need to compare these two techniques to understand which are the plus and the minus of the both technique. And to do this, we need, of course, to incorporate these techniques in clinical trials. And this, for fortunately, have been done and is ongoing in several countries. Thank you.